Hey everyone, before we get started, I wanted to let you know that there's an exciting new PBS series called Weathered, Earth's Extremes, as well as some new merch available in the merch store. More info at the end of the episode. We know that the universe is getting bigger, and we know that the speed that the universe is getting bigger is also getting bigger. The standard assumption is that the cosmic acceleration rate itself is at least constant, which will surely result in the ultimate heat death of the universe. But a recent survey of primordial sound waves frozen into the way galaxies are sprinkled through the universe reveals that this fate is now in question. Back in 1998, we discovered that the expansion of the universe is accelerating. This rates as one of the most important findings in the past several decades in physics. That's because dark energy, our placeholder name for whatever causes this acceleration, is utterly mysterious and maybe the clue we need to move beyond our current understanding of physics. To be clear, we do understand the math of how dark energy works. Just add a constant energy density to the fabric of space and you get accelerating expansion, represented by the cosmological constant in Einstein's general theory of relativity. These days, almost all of cosmology assumes something called the lambda CDM model. CDM for cold dark matter, not a topic of this video, and lambda for the cosmological constant. We even have a prime candidate for this sort of unchanging dark energy. We expect fluctuations in the quantum fields to produce such a constant energy density, resulting in an energy of the vacuum that behaves exactly like a cosmological constant. Problem is, with our current understanding of the quantum field in our universe, we would expect those quantum fluctuations to most naturally do one of two things: to cancel out to exactly zero, or to pile up to an enormous universe-destroying value. It's very, very difficult to see how those fluctuations should produce such a tiny but non-zero vacuum energy without extreme fine-tuning of the field parameters. There are proposals for how this fine tuning may have happened. For example, we could be an extremely rare universe with a habitable value for the vacuum energy among a multitude of desolate ones. But if you don't like these anthropic arguments, we could also reject the idea that dark energy is vacuum energy at all. For example, it might be an undiscovered quantum field. One thing that a new quantum field might be expected to do is to change in strength over time, which would lead to a changing rate of acceleration. So how would we look for a changing acceleration rate? Detecting that the expansion was accelerating at all required us to map the changing size of the universe back in time. This was done by determining the distances to a type of supernova, type 1a supernovae, or exploding white dwarf stars. This approach gave us the expansion history over the most recent half of the age of the universe. That's enough to show that the expansion rate is changing, but not enough to see whether the change in that rate is itself changing. We also have a data point at the beginning of time with the cosmic microwave background radiation. If you compare the expansion rates predicted by these two methods assuming a constant acceleration, you get a mismatch. The CMB measure gives an expansion rate smaller than the supernova measure. This is the now famous crisis in cosmology. Many believe that there's a systematic error in these measurements somewhere, but another possibility is that the assumption of constant acceleration is wrong. It's starting to sound like it would be a good idea to properly map the expansion history back through as much of cosmic time as possible with a single method. Then the acceleration history should be clear, and with it the constancy or non-constancy of dark energy. Unfortunately, we can't see supernovae at large enough distances, and the CMB is only at the furthest distance, by definition. But we do have another option: baryon acoustic oscillations, BAOs. BAOs are like standard rulers that stretch all the way back to the beginning of the universe. We've talked about them before, but let me give you a refresher. In the few hundred thousand years right after the Big Bang, the entire universe was filled with hot plasma, and no stars or even atoms had formed. This plasma flowed into regions of higher gravity that would later collapse into clusters of galaxies. As these massive inflows crashed together, vast sound waves reverberated back out, creating expanding shells of higher density material. These sound waves, could travel because matter was locked together with the intense radiation that filled the universe. But as the universe also expanded, it cooled, and at some point the first atoms formed. Matter and light were no longer locked together, and so our sound waves stopped moving. The pattern of those waves became frozen into the distribution of matter at the moment a few hundred thousand years after the Big Bang. Later, galaxies and clusters would form from this matter. Most galaxies would form near the centers of the large overdensities, but there should be much weaker shells of overdensities surrounding each of these, where the sound waves were frozen. We see these baryon acoustic oscillations in the cosmic microwave background the light carried to us from the moment of that freezing. But we also see that there are rings of galaxies distantly surrounding galaxy clusters. This is an incredibly faint signal, observable only as a slightly higher probability of finding galaxies separated by the diameter that those rings have today. That diameter is called the sound horizon of the BAOs, the maximum distance that sound travelled before freezing, and it's around 500 million light years after having expanded with the rest of the universe. This number is our standard ruler. We know how big the sound horizon should be at any point in the history of the expanding universe. By measuring the angular size of this horizon on the sky, we can find the true physical distance corresponding to the galaxies on these BAO rings. With one more ingredient, that translates to an expansion history of the universe. That final ingredient is redshift, and this is exactly what the Dark Energy Spectroscopic Instrument measures. DESI is a pretty amazing instrument and survey. It measures redshifts, the amount that light is stretched as it travels to us through an expanding universe. We've been able to measure redshifts since the 1920s. That's how we discovered the expansion of the universe in the first place. But DESI is able to measure redshifts for 5,000 galaxies or quasars at a time. For every patch on the sky, 5,000 robots place as many optical fibers at precise locations on a plate, corresponding to the precise locations of galaxies in that patch. Light from those galaxies then travels the optical fiber down to a spectrograph where it's split into component wavelengths. Characteristic spikes in emission due to known elements in each galaxy then reveal the redshifts. In this way, DESI has been able to measure redshifts for 26 million galaxies and quasars so far, and their plan is to get to 40 million by the end of the survey. This will ultimately result in a giant three-dimensional map of the universe over the past 11 billion years. Combined with the size of the BAO rings at each redshift, this also gives us a map of the expansion history. Back in April of this year, the DESI collaboration published a series of papers with the results from the first year of the survey, from those 6 million redshifts. One of those papers covered the baryon acoustic oscillations, in which they determined the constraints of a few cosmological parameters. One of these is something called omega, which gives the so-called equation of state of dark energy. It tells us how much pressure is being produced for a given energy density. In lambda CDM, we expect omega to equal exactly -1 for all of time. And the DESI results are in very good agreement with omega equal -1 and constant dark energy, just as we have always assumed. That sounds anticlimactic, but then something odd turned up. The DESI team combined the sound horizon measurements from their redshift survey with sound horizon measurements from two other types of survey, from the Planck satellite measurements of the cosmic microwave background at the beginning of time, and with a few supernova surveys of the more modern universe. Adding these other surveys led to an unexpected result. The combined data were better fit with a model with omega greater than -1, and in which dark energy is getting weaker over time. And that's the case whether the CMB or supernova results were added to DESI separately or together. The statistical significance of this result depends on which combination of data sets you look at. It's 2.6 sigma for DESI plus CMB, and up to nearly 4 sigma for a particular one of the supernova samples included. 2.6 sigma is considered not statistically significant, although it's still worthy of curiosity and more observations. 4 sigma is getting exciting. even if it's short of the normal 5 sigma threshold for a very likely positive detection. But we should also be quite wary of that 4 sigma result, because it depends on inferring distances from supernovae. The BAO sound horizons measured this way are probably more subject to systematic errors than the CMB results. That's because supernova distances depend on a longer chain of distance measurements, and so there are more places that some error could have crept in. Okay, let's allow ourselves to get excited just for a minute and ask what this means if it's true. Well, one of the more general models for non-constant dark energy is called quintessence, which has an equation of state that can change over time. The Desi paper focuses on a version of this stuff called thawing quintessence, in which an initially constant dark energy sort of defrosts, becoming variable over time. And Desi finds that this model is more consistent with the various combined surveys than constant dark energy. If dark energy behaves this way, then it's less likely it will reverse course and start to get stronger in the future, and that may preclude big rip scenarios in which dark energy gets so powerful that it shreds the fabric of spacetime. So the universe hopefully doesn't end as we described in this episode. The opposite extreme to a big rip is the big crunch, in which the expansion eventually slows, then turns around and the universe collapses into a reverse big bang, potentially even kickstarting a new universe. We don't expect that to happen even with no dark energy whatsoever. The current expansion rate is enough to keep the universe expanding forever, even ignoring dark energy and including the slowdown from the inward gravitational pull of galaxies. If the density of dark energy is diminishing and eventually hits zero, that won't stop eternal expansion, although it will hold off the accompanying heat death for a while at least. To get a big crunch, dark energy would have to change in a more fundamental way. It would have to shift to a positive gravitational force rather than a negative one. And that's not impossible. If the equation of state parameter omega also changes, like in quintessence models, and in particular if it rises from the current negative 1 to negative 1/3 or higher, then dark energy stops behaving like dark energy at all and could actually work to recollapse the universe. Then we might get a proper crunchy end to the universe after all. But perhaps the most exciting outcome of the discovery of a non-constant dark energy is that it may constrain other physics. We've been a bit stuck on this in the past few decades, unable to move beyond general relativity and the standard model of particle physics. Things like string theory seemed promising, but have trouble generating testable predictions. String theory is especially challenging because it predicts a myriad of possible universes called the string landscape, and it seems impossible to determine how to identify our universe in that space. Well, back in 2018, a team of theoretical physicists showed that only a subset of the string landscape should lead to stable universes, and that a requirement of that stability of that subset is that dark energy should diminish over time. So perhaps we have our first tested prediction of string theory, and string theorists are going to be pretty excited if the Desi result pans out. Okay, one final word. I mentioned the crisis in cosmology, the tension between the CMB supernova measurements and the expansion rate as measured by the Hubble constant. This Hubble tension could be resolved with a changing acceleration rate. Unfortunately, the acceleration rate would have to increase to resolve the tension, not decrease as Desi is suggesting. In fact, the Desi results do also infer an expansion rate, a Hubble constant, and they actually support the Planck CMB result, not the supernova result. So it seems we have to be tense about the Hubble constant for a while longer. And once again, please remember that this result has not reached the threshold of statistical significance that we need for a confident declaration of a discovery. We'll learn more soon though. Desi has actually completed the second year of observations, and its results will come out faster than the first year results. So we'll see if the finding firms up or evaporates. And in a few years, when Desi has observed all 40 million galaxies and quasars, and we have results from other current or future programs such as the Dark Energy Survey and the Vera Rubin Observatory, we will gradually be able to hone in on a more precise value of the equation of state of dark energy. And then we should know one way or another, do we have a cosmological constant or a cosmological variable? and perhaps we'll finally understand what dark energy actually is and have evidence for the underlying theory of everything that supports this, and even know the final fate of our expanding space-time. Hi everyone, before we go, I wanted to tell you about an exciting new PBS long-form documentary series, Weathered Earth's Extremes. This six-part, 30-minute per episode series is an evolution of the PBS Terra YouTube series and rigorously examines the data to understand how our climate is shifting. In this series, host Maya May meets with the scientists and communities at the front line of our changing weather experiences and explores the actionable steps that we can take to develop a more resilient future. All episodes will be available globally on pbs.org as well as on the PBS app and streaming platforms in the US. The first long-form episode focusing on climate tipping points is out now, and there are links in the description. I also wanted to tell you about our latest UV glow t-shirt and hoodie. As you know, one of the long-standing rules of PBS Spacetime is that it's never aliens. But the full rule is that it's never aliens until it is. And in case you happen to run into aliens and want to communicate that you are open to leaving the Earth, then take a look at our Take Me With You UV Glow t-shirt and hoodie. Both the t-shirt and hoodie are UV charged, so after being out in the sun they'll begin to glow, which is perfect for signalling aliens in the dark. Because of the UV printing process, we're only able to print a limited number. The shirts will be on sale until October 31st, but if you'd like to receive your shirt before Halloween, then you'll need to put in your order by October 16th. We're also extending the sale of our Universal Speed Limit patch and light cone pin until October 13th. Check out pbsspacetime.com/shop and check them out. There's a link in the description.